Hello, good day. This is Munir Ajam. In this video, we are going to take a slightly different approach where we are presenting slides. And I will be speaking over the slides as we proceed. Although the slides are self-explanatory, I will be adding my comments, obviously. Before I go into this presentation, let's talk about why. This short presentation. We have introduced a methodology a few years back, and I will talk more about this as we go through the slide. However, as we talk to clients today, and clients that are not necessarily interested in certification, and when we offer them, studying a guide like the PMBOK guide alone versus studying the methodology, the vast majority of the client are choosing the methodology over this. And this year alone, we have done already most of the courses we have delivered this year has been on the CAMP model. However, some client, when they see something, a name they don't recognize, and they don't have the time to dig into it or to even ask questions about it, they presume that this is an alternate to the PMBOK guide, especially with the popularity of the PMBOK guide, or they think this is there to replace the guide. Obviously, many of these clients are probably doesn't come from project management background, do not fully understand what the PMBOK guide is, or that the fact that the PMBOK guide itself, in the body of the guide, in the notice page and in chapter one, advocate the need to use a methodology to go with the guide, because the PMBOK guide is general framework, it's a guideline for managing project. It's not a methodology. And we have recorded many videos on these topics before, explaining that the PMBOK guide is not a methodology. And again, this is not an opinion of Munir Ajam. This is what's written in the PMBOK guide. And therefore, the guide advises us, the volunteer who wrote the guide advises us to use methodologies. Now, why we don't hear enough about methodologies? We don't hear a lot about methodologies because methodologies are typically custom built or tailored to an organizational need. In other words, they are internal set of processes and functions and tools that are used within organization, and therefore we don't see enough being communicated on methodology. And again, methodologies are variable, whereas a PMBOK guide focus or ISO 21500, a guidance to project management, focus is that at basically look, we want to be generic for most project most of the time. That was basically the reason behind this presentation, is to educate and to help people understand that what CAMP does is actually encompass guide like the PMBOK guide or ISO 21500. It's there to supplement them, to go beyond them rather than replace them. These guides are highly popular and they have a lot of usage, including in CAMP. CAMP, we are using these references. With this introduction, let's go on. Let's go through the presentation and to see what this is all about. Today, what we have, obviously, we have many other things besides what I'm going to show on the screen. But the most popular today in project management is PMP certification, the PMBOK guide, and ISO 21500, although it's relatively new, it's gaining some in popularity. But they're both quite similar in some aspect. ISO used when it was designed, when ISO 21500 was developed, it included people from various international organization standard, such as the American National Standard Institute and many other countries participated in the development of ISO 21500. So obviously, ISO 21500 will end up taking some content or some similarities to a popular guide like the PMBOK guide. So, but today both of them are quite similar, and they both depend on 10, what ISO calls subject, with the red color. There are 10 subjects. Whereas the PMBOK have what you call 10 knowledge areas. Mostly identical with some minor exception that ISO have a subject area called resource management, where PMBOK have a human resource management. However, in the sixth edition of the Pumbaa Guide, they will end up matching. So basically all 10 topics, knowledge areas or subject or function, depending what you want to call them, are about the same. Both guide have 5 process groups, although the naming might be slightly different. For example, the Pumbaa Guide uses the terms initiating, planning, executing, monitoring and controlling and closing, whereas ISO uses initiating and planning, the same as Pumbaa, but instead of executing, they use implementing, and instead of monitoring and controlling, they use controlling only, and of course, closing. So 5 process group in both situation. One difference, however, is in the number of processes. The ISO guide is focusing on 21500 ISO, as that has 39 processes, whereas the Pumbaa guide has 47 processes as per the 5th edition of the guide. Now, I have to be careful here. I'm comparing ISO and Pumbaa, but technically that's not 100% correct. Yeah, ISO is the standard guidance, or is not the standard, is a guidance to project management. It's a document that is about 40 pages. The Pumbaa guide is a general guide that is more than 600 pages. However, in the Pumbaa guide, in the 5th edition, Annex 1 is the ANSI, the American National Standard Institute approved standard. So technically, for proper comparison, we should be comparing ISO 21500 with the ANSI approved standard that is included in the Pumbaa guide as Annex 1, which is about 40 pages. So they are, you know, in that case, they are really comparing apples and apples. Otherwise, we are really comparing, if we compare ISO 21500 to the whole Pumbaa guide, it's like we are comparing an apple to a case full of apples. Yeah. So basically, of course, the Pumbaa guide have all different type of apples, small in size and large and, you know, you name it. So basically, again, to properly compare, we should compare ISO 21500 with the ANSI approved PM standard that is an annex in the Pumbaa guide. But this is a quite general view. Step back for a second. SUCAD have been developing and publishing and writing articles and blogs and published ebooks and published books on CAMP. And in 2007-2008, we had version 1. And about 2013, we had version 2, which is all the published books that we have so far are based on version 2. And we just finished late in 2016, early this year, we finished the third variation or the third edition or the third version of CAMP that I'm going to be discussing here today. With that in mind, so CAMP version 3, that is, we have just finished also a book about it. And right now we are in the process of the editing with the publisher. And that should be released in the, is planned for release in August 2017. It should have been the release in second quarter, but it has been delayed for various reasons. No time to get into them at this time. So basically, with this, with the third edition of CAMP, the first thing we have done, and this is based on our experience, the reaction with the client, our understanding and subject matter expertise and the Pumbaa guide, we have changed this concept that is presented in the Pumbaa guide and ISO from 5 process group to 6. And instead of having 10 subject or knowledge area, now we have 12 and we call them functions like cost and scope. I'm not gonna go into a lot of details right now about what are these functions are. But as a result of this, we have end up with 76 processes. Now, of course, these 76 processes are not just because we have 12 functions. There are many processes embedded in the Pumbaa guide implicitly, but that does not have dedicated processes. We have added those among other things. For example, the Pumbaa guide says we have to appoint a project manager in the initiation process group, but doesn't have a dedicated process for it. The Pumbaa guide talks about we have to mobilize a project management team, but does not have a dedicated process for it. Staying with HR, the Pumbaa talks about the need for having to control the team. That's the process is missing from the Pumbaa guide today. So these three things, for example, I just mentioned three topics that are in the Pumba guide, but they don't have a dedicated process. Similarly, in many other function and many other knowledge areas, we have that, which end up going from 47 to 76 processes. The vast majority of those processes are implicit in the PMBOK or ISO, but they're not there mentioned explicitly. And some of them, of course, are due to the additional process group and the two function. So basically, if we look at the pictures again, now we have six process groups, 12 functions, 76 processes. And here in this picture, we are showing where we have deviated, is that basically in the planning area. The planning process in the PMBOK guide, now we have split them into two separate process groups, or we call them processes, main processes. One of them is management planning, which is the developing the detail, the plan to help us, to guide us on how to plan, manage, and control the project. And there is a detailed plan that include all the detailed processes that are more product oriented or project oriented processes, such as a detailed scope of work, detailed scheduling, and so forth and so on. Again, we are not spending, not going to expend too much into this. We're just highlighting the key principles. Maybe in the future we can elaborate further. So the camp first step was to transform the concept of the process group moving from five process group to six, and of course 10 to 12 functions, and the number of processes jump from 47 to 76. So this is what we call one of the dimension, because the camp is a three-dimensional model. So one of the dimension of the model focuses on the processes and function that were are mentioned in the ISO or PMI. Next, the next step that Sukad has done is that basically said, look, what's missing is a methodology, or in other words, a project lifecycle. Because methods are usually related to project lifecycles. So we have developed our own, and this picture you see here is based on the third version of the camp. And of course, what you see on the top layer, we have the title project lifecycle as a project level. And then we use the concept of phases. We have three phases: discovery phase, development phase, and delivery phase. If you go back to our YouTube channel, you will find out we have recorded videos on these topics before. So if you want to get more details, you can go back and look for them. The video, they are numbered and they will have the name of like discovery phase or development phase. And of course, below the phases, each phase is broken down into stages, such as the discovery phase have two stages, the development have three stages, and delivery have four stages. Again, these are explained in prior videos. So this is a standard model, we should say. However, the key is, and we have not spoken much about the name yet, CAMP stands for the Customizable and Adaptable Methodology for Managing Project. Basically, what from the name is telling us, we have to customize and adapt the model. Based on what? We will touch on this a bit later. So this is a standard model, and what we are saying is that one size fits all does not work in project management. So in any organization, in any sectors, in any industry, you have to take a model like this and customize it, adapt it based on the project types that you work in within your organization. And could be there could be more than one project type. Therefore, you could have more than one method. Yeah. So within the same organization, we can have numerous methods. Each method is to different type of project. For example, one method for IT project, internal IT project, one method for capital investment project or facilities project, one method for basically business process or small internal training or HR type of project. Now, what you see on the screen we haven't talked about yet are the numbers 1, 2, 3, 4. These are what we call stage gates. Again, they're explained in other videos. So this is in the CAMP model. This is the primary dimension. This is the first dimension of the model. with the function and processes that we discussed earlier as the second dimension, although we discussed them out of sequence to help understand better understand the situation. Now let's pause for a second and reflect back on the previous slide. What we have is that the process groups, I know in the Pumbaa they're written and they say, for example, the initiating processes are to initiate a project or phase, the planning processes are to help plan a project or phase, but in reality, if you really dig into it and you want to do it properly, these are for the stages or phases of the project, not for the project itself. For example, the develop project charter, the name called develop project charter, so it has the word project in it, but as you read the information, you will find out it's basically the document that authorizes a project or a phase. The PM developed the project management plan process. It's about developing the plan to manage the project or phase. There is a bit of inconsistency in the Pumbaa here. And again, I don't want to spend more time on this. You can go back to other videos we have recorded on this as well. But basically, what our view is, our professional view is, the processes that we see in the Pumbaa guide or ISO or SCAMP, the 76 processes, are there to manage a phase or a stage of the project. They are not to manage the whole project, unless the project is extremely small and simple. Yeah. In other words, there is something missing if we depend only on the processes. Now, I'm going to repeat something I said earlier. ISO and PMI guides both call for the need to use method to supplement the processes. So basically, what that something is missing, as we highlighted before, and we're repeating again, is a method. Yeah, methods are typically based on a systematic approach: 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, sequence, overlap, waterfall, agile concept. Although what agile is not a methodology, but there are some methodologies under the agile framework that might follow a certain way of doing things. Method typically for a project lifecycle with phases or stages or certain sequence. Method has to be tailored to a given project type. Basically, that's the missing piece, and not as an error, that's the missing piece by design from ISO and PMI, because they are trying to focus on having guides that are generic for most projects most of the time. So they are not there to be tailored to a specific industry or domain or type of project. This is why, you know, organizations develop their own methods, and SUCAD have done this to be used in the public domain. So relating these two dimensions, the first dimension being a project lifecycle, and the second dimension being the process group, what we see here is that for medium to moderate complexity project, now what is that? Each organization has to define its own small to simple project, medium or moderate complexity project, and large and complex project, or any other classification system they want to follow. For what we classify as medium to moderate complexity project, and we have three phases in the standard life cycle model we have, what we say and advocate and advise and insist, if you want to really look for the best way or leading practices in managing project and delivering project successfully, you should apply the process group, at least most of them that apply, in every phase of the project. So basically, the 76 processes, maybe 60 or 70 of them should be done. Maybe 50 of them will be done in the discovery phase, and maybe all of them could be done in the delivery phase. Ideally, most of them would be applicable in every phase. Now, of course, not everyone will be starting from scratch. Things could be updated. Like, for example, if we use, we have a process, for example, for selecting and mobilizing a project manager. If we use that process during the initiating part of the discovery phase, do I have to use it again in the development phase? Well, of course, if the project manager is staying on the job, not applicable, no need for it. However, if we are changing the project manager, then yes, we need to go through that process again. Same thing, managing the team. Project or selecting and mobilizing a project management team, which we mentioned earlier. Well, we mobilize some people in the discovery phase, we mobilize more people in the development phase, and we mobilize maybe more and more people in the delivery phase. So do I need to repeat that process? Yes, but I'm not repeating from scratch. I'm just building on what I have done before. So some processes could be done totally from scratch again. However, most of them are there and they could be not applicable if they're done before and there's no need to update them. However, for large, so another way we're saying here, the process group repeat in every phase. Now, as they become large and complex, we have to go to the process groups. You know, that's what you see, the oval shapes in the middle, actually repeat in every stage. Well, maybe not every stage, depend on the nature of the project. Maybe in the concept stage, we don't need it. Okay, then it's not applicable. So we have to customize it. But as a concept, what we are saying, we should consider applying the process group in every stage of the project. Obviously, stages like implementation are much, much bigger than maybe a stage like the requirement stage, but still is a stage. The thought process is the same, and we have to go through the initiating a stage. We have to plan it. We have to execute it or implement it. We have to control it, and we have to close it. Now, as we mentioned already, CAMP is a three-dimensional model. The project lifecycle is the first dimension. The processes and function are the second dimension. The third step we took in CAMP version 3, which is the third dimension, is basically the concept of adding advanced topic as layers on top of the first two dimensions. So along on top of the lifecycle or the processes, we have to look for advanced topic. And these topics are what is necessary to help organization move forward on the journey to center of excellence. If they want to elevate their performance to a high level of maturity, they have to consider these additional concepts as we present on this slide. What are these? Well, today on this slide, in our book, we present four topics. Of course, we could add more or less, depend on the nature of the industry, on the project types. What are these? We need to have a project success model to look at project success, and which also is a major contributor to the concept of benefit realization, a topic that has been ignored by organizations like PMI in the past at the project level. But recently, you know, almost every message we see from PMI talk about benefit realization. Well, benefit realization is directly linked to project success and delivering on the objective. Another important topic that is highly current in today's environment is sustainability. And we have also the concept of competence, not necessarily knowledge. Knowledge is good, but we need to elevate performance. We need to move from having knowledge to having skills to build competency and competence of the people involved to the highest level possible. And there are some best practices or leading practices. Now, as a knowledge source for these four advanced topics, because CAMP look for integrating knowledge from different organizations, the project success model is a model we developed in SOCAD. It's called the four dimensions of project success. That's the model we're using here. For sustainability, there is a leading organization on this in project management today, GPM Global, based out of the US. For competence, obviously PMI have some competence framework, but in our view on project management, the leader in competence development is IPMA and its members from the UK to Australia to other countries around the world. And for leading practices, these has to be linked to a specific industry. That's why we listed here various. For example, in the capital project industry, process industry, oil and gas, CII, the Construction Industry Institute, is probably the most known or well-defined organization that have specifically defined, I believe, 17, what they call them. They use the term best practices. We prefer the word leading practices. So this is the third dimension of CAMP. In other words, CAMP is a three-dimensional methodological approach. We're repeating and summarizing. It integrates learning from PMI, ISO, IPMA, GPM Global, and many others, along with the SOCAD research and development that we have done, such as the four dimension of project control. We also have the six steps of project control. Sorry, the four dimension of project success, the four control reference points model, and the six steps of project control model, which I did not discuss today. But these are some of the things we have developed in SOCAD, along with the CAMP approach, of course, and the seven elements of project management maturity, which is an organizational project management system. And to reconfirm what we just said, it has to be tailored, customized. Basically, tailoring mean customized to a sector, industry, or organization. It has to be adapted to a division or function. And of course, at the end of the day, it must incorporate project classification, such as for size and complexity. As we have mentioned before, small and simple project versus medium and moderate complexity, or large and complex project. Basically, CAMP offer us flexibility, but yet with the proper discipline that is we exercise through the concept of stages and phases and stage gates and process gates. So there has to be flexibility where we can adapt, we can tailor, we can customize. However, without losing the principal concept in project management, that project management must be a disciplined approach. With this, I come towards the end. If you want to read more, the SOCAD way, .socad.com, is basically where we have some of our research work. Multimedia, where we list our some of our publication, and the blog. We have actually yesterday, March 22, we have superseded 300,000 views on our blogs, where many of the articles are related to SCAMP, but there are, of course, other articles. We have also published ebooks on CAMP. We have 7 ebooks published on CAMP and 2 ebooks published on the PMBOK guide. We have been working with the global leader in ebook publishing, BookBoon.com. So basically, if you want to get copies of these books, you can go through BookBoon and search on my name and you will find all my books. For printed books, we have so far self-published 3 or 4 books. They are on authorhouse.com, but you can also get them from amazon.com, and you can search on my name as well. They are Project Management Foundation. There is Redefining the Basics of Project Management. There is Applying Project Management, and our very first book is The Inheritance. It's on Amazon. Coming this summer by CRC Press, we have Project Management Beyond Waterfall and Agile. This is our newest book that reflects the CAMP version 3, and it's expected to be released this summer. And you can check it out with the link here to see it on the CRC Press website, with some information about the books and including some outlines. Of course, there are the videos in Arabic and English, such as this one, on the SOCAD YouTube channels, which you can access through this link here. We say thank you. We appreciate your listening. Long video, much longer than our typical videos, but at least with the slides, you can follow the slide and the presentation. At least we save you looking at my face for 15 minutes. My personal website is munirajam.com. You can also visit to learn more about me if you are interested. Again, thank you and appreciate your time under another opportunity. Have a great time.